Hi, this is Mandy from Frederick Meijer Gardens and Sculpture Park, and today we are talking about the absolute most coolest, most unusual plants there are, carnivorous plants. Okay, so carnivorous plants.
My name is Mandy. I'm a horticulturist here at Frederick Meijer Gardens and Sculpture Park, and I take care of the Kenneth E. Nelson Carnivorous Plant House as well as the Carnivorous Collection.
One thing to note with them is they grow in soils which lack nutrients. So they grow in acidic soils, and these soils are very wet. So with these plants, they've learned to adapt over time, and they've learned to get their nutrients elsewhere. Now they get their nutrients from eating insects. So with carnivorous plants, there's several different types of carnivorous that have different adaptations, and today I'm going to talk about that a little bit.
So this particular pitcher plant that I'm going to show you, this is a tropical pitcher plant, Nepenthes truncata. The pitchers on this particular plant can grow up to a foot in height.
And we have these in our carnivorous display. They're in our back bog bed. When you come to visit, you'll have to check them out. They're pretty cool. But these plants will eat small rodents and amphibians. Pretty scary, huh? So with the tropical pitcher plants, they are known as a pitfall trap. Now by pitfall, what you'll see, this is how they are. They have a peristome up here around the pitcher itself. And the peristome has glands that secrete nectar. Insects are drawn into the nectar that is secreted. They fly in or crawl onto the pitcher, and it's like a slippery slope. They fall into the pitcher like a pitfall. And unfortunately, in most pitchers, there's downward pointing hairs, and the insects will fall in, and it's like a slippery slope. They slide right down into the pitcher, and unfortunately they can't get back out. And then inside the pitcher itself, there's a lot of liquids, digestive enzymes and fatty acids that break down insects over time. So that's how they feed and trap insects. And there's a lot of different species of tropical pitcher plants. This is one of my favorites. This is the white collared pitcher plant, which you can see it has that white little rim around the peristome there. And this is a very unique pitcher plant that you don't see very often. And then here is another really neat pitcher plant species. This is the red leopard tropical pitcher plant. And this one you can see has a very colorful striped peristome and pitcher on it, so it's a very unique species. That's one thing I absolutely love about pitcher plants, because they're so different. All the pitchers have different markings and colors and stripes and features, so they're probably my most favorite carnivorous plant here. And then we do have some pitcher plants that are actually found in the Americas. So this particular species is a great northern pitcher plant, and this can actually be found in Michigan, which is pretty cool. But it's also native to Canada, as well as the surrounding states around the Great Lakes. And they function the same way with that pitfall trap, but they're very colorful, as you can see. So another type of pitcher plant, a North American species, is this particular one. This is a Sarracenia species. And with this one, it has the same pitfall trap on it, but one unique thing to note is if you look closely, it has these white windows on the pitcher, and with these little white windows, it confuses insects that will fly in, and they think that there is a way out of these pitchers, so they fly towards the little white specks, the little white windows, and unfortunately, they're fake windows, and insects get confused and they buzz around and then they get tired and they fall down into the pitcher, into the liquid below, and sadly drown. So that's how they function, but it's a neat adaptation with the Sarracenia species. These Sarracenia species, these American pitcher plants, are found along the coast of the United States. They grow from New Jersey downward through the Carolinas, as well as Georgia, Florida, and then over through the Gulf states. So Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Texas, So that's where they live. Now there is a particular species of pitcher plant that I don't have an example of, but the Darlingtonia species, which is a cobra pitcher plant. Cobra, it gets that name because the pitcher actually resembles a cobra, which is pretty cool. And those particular species are found along the West Coast, so you'll see them in Oregon, Washington, and California. And then we do have some other carnivorous plants here. These are the sundews. This particular sundew is a Cape sundew, so that's native to Australia. And these are considered flypaper traps. And so it gets that name because it has these tentacles on them, like an octopus. And these tentacles are coated with this sticky dew or mucilage. And the insects will fly and get drawn into that sticky dew, the nectar, and when they fly in, they get stuck on those tentacles, and the tentacles in most species will wrap around the insect and hold it tight. And from there, there's all sorts of digestive enzymes and fatty acids that are released that will break down that insect over time. So they're pretty tough plants, pretty gruesome. There's some unique little flowers in here. These are actually flowers of another type of carnivorous plant, the bladderwort. And that's a bladder trap with these bladderworts. And bladderworts grow underneath the soil surface in wet, boggy marshes. And they actually feed under the water surface. So with bladderworts, they have these little bladders on down below in the water. These bladders have little trigger hairs on the outside, and insects will, microorganisms or mosquito larvae will come over to these little trigger hairs, and there's a little trap door that opens, and this bladder acts as like a vacuole, and it will suck the insect in to the trap, and then the trap door will close, and that's how bladderworts feed and function. We do have this is probably my most favorite sundew species. This is a forked sundew, or Drosera binata. And you can see it has these really unique sundew tentacles on it that are forked. So it's a really cool plant. So another unique type of flypaper trap is the butterwort. And this particular species, also known as pinguicula, has these leaves, and the leaf surfaces are coated with this nectar from the glands, and it secretes those digestive enzymes from those glands as well. So insects will fly in and they land on the surface thinking they'll feed on that nectar, and they get stuck to the surface of the leaf like a flypaper. And these two species that we have are tropical species of butterworts, and they're, you can see this one is in bloom right now, which is rather beautiful, and they're both species found in Mexico. So next I'm going to talk about the snap trap, which snap traps are Venus fly traps. And with these Venus fly traps, they're known as Dionaea, that's the genus, and this particular fly trap is rather cool how it functions. It has these leaflets. With the snap trap, there's trigger hairs on the inside of the lobes of the leaves in the trap. An insect will be drawn in to the nectar that's secreted from the glands, and once an insect touches these trigger hairs that are on these leaf surfaces, there's a mild electric current that runs through the cells of the leaf surface. These cells that are on the outer walls of the leaf lobes lengthen in less than a second, and then the lobe rapidly reverses itself and the trap snaps shut on the insect. With these traps, it usually takes about 5 to 7 days for it to fully digest an insect, and then once it's finished digesting and breaking down that insect, the trap will reopen, and all that's usually left is the exoskeleton. Now, one thing to note with these Venus fly traps, I know it's very tempting to touch them, but you really shouldn't touch them too much. And the reason I say that is because when you touch these traps, if you don't have an insect that you put into the traps, you're actually really weakening the plant over time. and it'll actually end up dying off with constant touching if you do that. So yeah, these particular carnivorous plants are only found native in North and South Carolina. So that's pretty neat. Of course, now they're hybridized and they're grown everywhere in the world, but they're one of my favorite carnivorous plants. Well, thank you guys so much for joining me today, and I hope you learned some really cool, unique things about these carnivorous plants that we have, and hopefully, you know, you've gained a newfound interest in these plants. And if you have any further questions or if you're curious about the care of these plants, please feel free to comment and leave your message in the comments below, and I'll be sure to get back with you. Thanks for joining me.